Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, confessions and promises on a deathbed, the impact on those left behind.
I found out that my husband was having a relationship with my sister.
He'd been living a double life for some years.
I think deathbed confessions are quite selfish.
Bill, you also call yourself the coffin confessor. What do you do?
I crash funerals on behalf of the deceased.
Why do you think some people would rather wait until their deathbeds to confess or to ask for something?
They think, well, there'll be no ramifications. I can tell you this and you have to deal with it. I don't have to deal with it anymore.
Thanks for being here. Vicky, 2 days before your mum went into a coma, she made a final request. What was it?
She requested that I come and visit her. We were estranged and I hadn't seen her for some time.
What was your relationship like with your mother in the lead up to her death?
It's always been difficult. She was a fundamental evangelical Christian and very strong and she liked to be in control. As a child, I learnt to be careful. I was very compliant. But as I grew older and started to write my own narrative as a married woman, I was continually coming under criticism from her.
What caused that estrangement with your mother?
I found out that my husband was having a relationship with my sister and I went to my mother because she'd had a similar experience in her life, and my motivation was that I thought she might be able to impart something to me to help me deal and cope with this. The first thing she said to me was, "You're crazy, you need psychiatric treatment." And then she went on to say that she'd known about it for some time. This was after I presented her with the evidence. She said she was aware that they were going out for coffees and seeing movies together. As far as she was concerned, they were just friends.
What was her last conversation with you?
She said to me, "If you could only see your sister, you'd see how happy she is. I cannot understand why you can't be happy. Just be happy. You have your house, you have your cat. Just be happy."
How did that stance make you feel?
Absolute betrayal. I felt discarded, devalued, and just loneliness, absolutely. I felt totally alone.
Why do you then think she wanted to see you when she was on her deathbed?
I would assume it would be to make amends. She probably wanted me to forgive her.
Did you fulfil her request to visit her before she died?
No, I didn't. I thought about it. I went for counselling, but I'd made the decision quite some time before, because I knew she was sick, that when this event happened that I wouldn't be going.
Megan, you were very close to your dad when you were growing up. When you were 23, you found out he had been keeping a secret. What was it?
I found out that he'd been living a double life for some years and that I had a half-brother who was only four and then also came out during that time, perhaps not on that first day, that he'd also married the lady in question that he'd been living a double life with. Mm-hmm. So that made him a bigamist because he was still married to my mother.
How did you react to this news that your dad had another wife and a four-year-old son?
I was just utter shock at the time. Just sort of came out of nowhere. It was nothing I could have ever imagined was about to occur in our family. I guess he was seemingly living happily married with my mum, although they had their challenges and difficulties, particularly financial.
Did you stay in contact with your dad after finding out this news?
Initially, there was a lot to resolve and practicalities to sort out after we initially found out. I had little to no contact with him for quite a few years after that.
Your dad try and repair that relationship with you?
Not for some years initially. I think because my mum was not doing so well in those first few years. And he knew how upset and angry I was. And I think he just was unable to confront and face up to the things that he'd done.
10 years after you found out about your dad having this second wife. You reconciled and visited him in Singapore. He was living there with his second wife and his son. What happened while you were there?
I went to Singapore with great optimism, thinking it was time to maybe try and repair the relationship. Dad and I went out just for our lunch on our own, some time together, to a dumpling restaurant. During the lunch, it came out that he'd actually met somebody else and that he was planning on ending his relationship with his second wife and starting a new, moving forward with the third lady, shall we say, to which I was, like, totally shocked, practically spat my dumpling all over him. I think in my anger it was something like, surely you wouldn't be silly enough to go ahead and have any more children or, you know, that sort of thing. And just the look on his face told me there obviously was a child.
Already.
So, yeah, after much pressing and fishing, he had to admit to me that there was a child. There was already a little girl and there was another one on the way.
How did you process this news?
Not very well at that particular moment. I'd been angry for many years anyway. Mm. So to sit there at a time that I'd initiated coming to Singapore, let's try and fix this, and I hear that he's not only done it again almost, and it came out that he'd actually had married this third lady as well. So now he's a double bigamist and he'd done a double life twice over. And I was floored. Like, how could this have happened twice? I guess I stormed out. My memory is patchy of that, what happened right then, but I certainly left.
In 2019, your dad was diagnosed with prostate cancer. Before he died, he asked you to promise him something. What was that?
He asked me sort of about 48 hours before he died, whether I would promise to look after the three young kids after he'd died.
This is his third family or his kids from his second and third family?
This is his third family and there were three children in the end.
What was your relationship like with him at the time?
We'd always had our ups and downs, but it had been a really gruelling 18 months since diagnosis, and I'd always been there as his support, medical power of attorney, you know, medical decisions. I think we were better than we'd ever been, but it was still challenging.
How did you react initially to his deathbed request?
I think I was so focused on the present moment, and it was such a brutal, nasty way to die. So I think at the time it was a lot to digest on top of holding his hand while he died.
Harley, you grew up in a conservative religious family.
Yes.
What happened to you when you were 14?
So when I was 14, I came out to my dad. At first I said I was bisexual because I thought he might accept that a bit more. And he reacted quite badly and put me in conversion therapy.
At 17, you then left home. Why was that?
I refused to go back to the conversion therapy, and my dad gave me the choice of doing that or leaving, and if I had stayed and done the conversion therapy, it would have killed me.
After that ultimatum, Harley, did you have a relationship with your family?
Not really. I occasionally spoke to my dad on the phone. Didn't really have anything to do with the rest of my family, and yeah, just phone contact only, where my dad was quoting the Bible at me all the time.
Did you ever consider cutting off ties totally?
I did. I found it very hard to do. The way my dad raised me, I was very dependent on my family and I was sort of couch surfing, but I did eventually cut contact completely.
This was when you were about 21?
Yes.
A few years after that, your dad reached out to you. Why did he do that?
He asked me to go see him in hospital. He had bowel cancer that had spread to the liver. I thought he wanted to throw the Bible at me again, wanted me to go back into conversion therapy. That's what I thought he wanted.
Instead, when you got there, he made a confession to you. What was that confession?
He apologised to me. He told me he was wrong and that the words he used was, he said, the world's a horrible place for queer people. And I thought I could change you because I knew I couldn't change the world.
What was it like to hear that from him?
I
just, I was completely shocked. Mm-hmm. I never thought I'd hear it from him. He, in 97, when I was 8 years old, he was very loud in going right against the debate with decriminalising homosexuality in Tasmania. He was telling me, you know, gay people get AIDS and go to hell. Mm. And they're drug addicts, and that's all you'll be if you're gay.
He also made a request of you. What did he ask?
He asked me to forgive him, and I told him I'd have to think about it.
Was he emotional at the time you're having this conversation?
He was crying, and I'd never seen him cry before.
Bronnie, you spent nearly a decade caring for people as they were dying. As a palliative care nurse, did patients confide in you?
Absolutely. They were very intimate conversations.
What sorts of things would they confess?
Wishing they hadn't worked so hard, wishing they hadn't lived a life expected of them rather than living a life true to themselves, wishing they'd stayed in touch with their friends. It went on and on.
Why do people confess or make requests on their deathbed?
I think by revealing those mistakes people have made and the things they wish they'd done differently, it does help dissolve the bad feelings around that, the guilt or the judgment. I think it really does bring people a lot of peace to be heard and to be able to share those things.
Jill, you call yourself an end-of-life care doula. What are some of the practical things you do to help the people who are dying and their families as well?
Generally, we're engaged by a client at a point of diagnosis with a life-limiting condition, or when someone's entering the dying phase as a result of the natural ageing process. So then from that point on, we walk with them and help them navigate what can be a very challenging time.
You used to be a palliative care nurse.
Yeah.
What kind of secrets or confessions would dying patients often share with you?
The thing that I found was reoccurring was confessions of being the victim of incest. Mm. And the repeated sexual violations of a little person that they had to bear their whole life and were not able to let anybody know about.
Why do you think they shared such personal, painful secrets or confessions with you?
So often we are spending a lot of time, sometimes well over 12 months with somebody, and towards the end of their time, it can be very physical, so we're doing a lot of intimate personal care, a lot of really intimate discussions. We form these really meaningful, deep connections with the people that we care for.
Does taking on these stories have an effect on you?
Yes, it does. I can still see the face of a very beautiful woman that I cared for, and she said to me that she had been raped by her father when she was 14. It had gone on all of her childhood, and her mother knew full well the whole time what was going on and did nothing. But she was sent away, and here's this child. It was the giving up of a child by a child. So she carried that burden with her whole life.
Bronnie, is there a particular confession that has stayed with you?
There was one gentleman that I worked with, and he had worked all his life and his wife had wanted him to retire early, and he could financially afford to do that, but he was very wrapped up in his identity at work, and it really was brought home to him how bad his mistake was when he decided to retire. But before he retired, he set a time limit of 1 year on it, and before he actually retired, his wife ended up dying, and he had to live with that regret and the guilt and the remorse around that. That is one that I find myself reflecting on still years later.
How did you respond when he told you this?
Well, I told him that we're all human and we learn through our mistakes, and the only thing he could do at this point was to try to forgive himself because he couldn't go back and change what had happened.
Megan, on your dad's deathbed, he requested you look after his three children from his third marriage. Did you agree to this request?
I just knew we were getting quite close to the end, and I knew how stressed he was about dying, and I just sort of felt I had no choice.
Had you forgiven him by then?
Oh, I don't know, Kumi. I think that's perhaps still a work in progress, but certainly at that time, during those final days, I dug deep, trying to find that final resolve for myself.
Harley, your dad asked you to forgive him just a few days before he died. Yeah. How did you weigh up whether you'd do that or not?
I was seeing a psychologist at the time. I spoke to them about it. And the thing they told me was, you can forgive, but that doesn't mean it was okay.
Why did you decide to forgive him?
Because I think my dad struggled with a lot of things because of his religion, and I'd never seen my dad that genuine. And I knew, not only for him but for me as well, for me to truly move on, I needed to forgive him.
Do you remember what he said to you when you said, I forgive you?
He cried and thanked me. And, yeah, he told me he loved me, which was... it's something I'd been waiting to hear since I was 8, so...
Vicky, you denied your mother's request to visit her on her deathbed. You said she wanted your forgiveness. Did you ever consider forgiving her?
Forgiveness was never an issue. I really believe in the power of forgiveness, and I was afraid of what she was going to say to me that I would have had to live with for the rest of my life, and I was afraid of my reaction if she did come out with sorry so late, when she could have been such a positive force in the initial event. To say sorry now is meaningless. It's like I didn't need to hear her say sorry. I needed to put myself, my own mental health, into place.
Amanda, you've had more than 30 years' experience helping people cope with grief and loss. Can it be challenging to deny a loved one's request?
Oh, absolutely. We hear of the challenge now, but also the necessity to care for yourself as the living. It can be much easier if you're actually not related and you don't have the baggage of all the years previously. But I think we also have to be really clear with ourselves about living an authentic life as we continue to live after the death of that relative.
Do you believe that deathbed promises are binding?
I think it's for the ethics of the individual. I really believe they are about easing the passing of the person. And I think they're binding if they are authentic. But if you're promising something to make someone feel better, then know that that's what you're doing.
Why do you think some people would rather wait until their deathbeds to confess or to ask for something?
There's been a secret that they've held, and they're talking about it now is really something that allows them to die in peace.
Right.
Sometimes they're doing things because they want to cause a bit of mischief or because they're not happy with what's happened in the past and they want to get their revenge. They think, well, there'll be no ramifications. I can tell you this and you have to deal with it. I don't have to deal with it anymore.
In short, I crash funerals on behalf of the deceased.
With respect, the arena that you work in is so far removed from my life philosophy and so far removed from our practice philosophy.
Like me, hate me, loathe me, I do not care. It's not about me. It's about the person in the coffin that has left a message. If you want to hear it, this is what it is. It's your loved one. If you don't, bugger off.
Bill, you're a private investigator. You also call yourself the coffin confessor. What do you do?
In short, I crash funerals on behalf of the deceased.
So people hire you, they tell you, say, a secret that they have while they're alive, and then they ask you to reveal that truth either at their funeral or when their will is being read?
Yeah, it could be at the funeral, the wake, the will reading, or it could be a private message to somebody delivered face-to-face. It's not a job for anybody that can just go and do it. It takes a little bit of nerve, but at the same time, It's a request that started, believe it or not, as a joke.
Tell us about your first client.
My first client was Graham. He was a gentleman that I'd been investigating a claim for. I got to know him only for a short while. He had cancer. He was close to death. We got to talking about death and the afterlife and all things surrounding death. And I suggested he do his own eulogy. He said he'd been to plenty of funerals where eulogies just aren't shown out of disrespect, or the families just don't show. And so I suggested I crash his funeral for him. And he took me up on the offer, and I did so.
What did he want you to say at his funeral?
He wanted me to out his best mate for trying to sleep with his wife while he was on his deathbed. Mm. He also asked me to remove three people from the congregation that he hadn't seen in 30 years, so why would they pay him their respects now when they could have, you know, seen him when he was alive?
And you went through with it?
Absolutely.
What was the response?
Shock. And I'm interrupting a funeral, you know, between, you know, loved ones sitting there and grieving and his best mates performing a eulogy, and I stand up, interrupt the funeral service and announce that his best mate's got to sit down, shut up or bugger off because the man in the coffin's got something to say and this is what it is. And I'll open the envelope and I'll read aloud exactly what was said.
Did the best man stay put, walk out?
He left pretty quickly.
Why do you think some people take this approach to confess after death?
Because the families are full of vultures and the people around them, they're just not the people they think they are. It's very hard for people when they're dying and they're lying there and they're thinking that their loved ones are going to come and see them and be surrounded by, you know, friends and everyone. But it's not the case. Mm. It's not the case at all. And I've been in situations where there's fights while the person's still alive about who's getting the car, the jewellery, the house. I mean, they're just vultures, so.
Is part of it to avoid confrontation, do you think?
Well, most of it's because they haven't got the strength to get up and punch the people in the face that are hurting them. That's really what it is. I mean, it's not all bad either. I mean, it's good, bad, funny and sad. There's quite a range of funerals that I've crashed.
How much do you charge?
Between $2,000 and $10,000, but they don't need the money where they're going and I never get a complaint.
You've said that one before, right?
Many times.
Bill, what are some of the recent confessions you've been asked to reveal?
There's one in waiting that I haven't revealed as yet. A gentleman who's 88 years of age. He's a remarkable man. Everybody around him thinks he's an astute businessman. His family think he's an astute businessman. Truth be told, he won lotto many years ago and a lot of money. He hasn't worked a day in his life. And he's quite a cool character, but he's left everybody quite a handsome sum, which is really nice, and that'll be handed out at the funeral as well.
So he wants people to know that he wasn't telling the truth when he said he was working, but here's some money for you as well.
He didn't hoard the money himself either. I mean, he spent it wisely and he invested in his children and his grandchildren and things like that. However, yes, he's going to his deathbed and he's going to reveal that he's a complete fraud, but, hey, live with it and enjoy what I'm leaving you.
When you say in waiting, these people are clearly still alive.
Yes.
Do you ever worry about how these confessions might affect friends and family?
I have no concern for those left behind. No care or concern.
So it's all about the client from
That's
your
correct.
Perspective. Amanda, what are your thoughts about a service like the one Bill is offering?
I think it's colluding with the narcissistic nature of the client. Why is it okay for someone who is now dead to wreak havoc and cause horrible outcomes for other people? If you don't have the courage to do it while you're alive, I can understand that instead of writing in the will that this is where the money came from, or instead of telling people that you can have someone doing that at the funeral, that's lovely, that's fine. But to create chaos between family members, to have people fighting with each other, it just sounds capricious and unpleasant, and I really don't see any good in it at all.
What if there's not the opportunity for someone who is dying to speak with family members, or there's a rift that just can't be mended?
In the olden days, we would write a letter. Nowadays, you could make a video. There's no reason why people couldn't themselves own what they're saying instead of handing it to someone else. When you hand it to someone else, you're not really owning it, and therefore you can be capricious. Using an intermediary doesn't help the person who's dying, and it doesn't sound like it helps the living very much either.
How do you feel about that response, Bill?
Well, it's coming from a psychologist. I mean, that people pay a psychologist to tell their stories, and yet this person saying that, you know, they should be the ones dealing with it, yet she's taking everybody else's secrets and listening to them and trying to resolve them. But at the end of the day, it is what it is, and it's a mic drop for the people that die and they want this service. If it wasn't a service that was going to continue, I would have thought, yeah, no worries, it's a one-off. Mm. But after so many and the requests and what I do now and what it's led into the other avenues, look, it's a service that's just, you know, it's unbelievable. And it's the vultures in the family. What gives them the right to divvy up people's assets? I mean, before they're even gone. Mm. I mean, that's, you know, they've got a right to have... It's their funeral anyway. Mm. Yeah, let them have their funeral. It's not... If you're going to think that funerals are for the living... You're disrespecting the person in the coffin, OK? It's their funeral. Let them have their say. And if it's through me, hey, albeit, don't shoot the messenger.
Bronnie, would you have recommended a service like this to any of your patients?
I think it's an interesting service and I do see its place, even though, personally, I'm not that comfortable with it. But there were a couple of people that had things to say to their family and didn't have the courage to say, to share things and felt their family didn't even know them. There was a gentleman in his 90s who his family were denying that he was even dying and he wanted them to know that he knew he was dying, and it would have been really helpful for him to be able to share those things afterwards. I had offered to be sort of the mediator and bring his family in while he was still alive to have that conversation, and he just said, no, it's just too hard, like, let them keep pretending because I know I'm going to die. So I think there's a lot of individual cases, and I tend to lean more towards the make the video or write the letter.
Jill, what do you think of a service like Bill's?
Well, Bill, with respect, the arena that you work in is so far removed from my life philosophy and so far removed from our practice philosophy that personally I would not be able to engage your services and I would not be able to recommend them.
Bill, do you come across this feeling of being your kind of a solo operator in the space? Why do you feel so passionate about it?
Because people have a right. They have a right to air what they want. And it's not a philosophy or anything else. It's people want a service and I give them the service. Whether you like it or not, I don't care. Like me, hate me, loathe me, I do not care. It's not about me. It's about the person in the coffin that has left a message. If you want to hear it, this is what it is. It's your loved one. If you don't, bugger off.
Have you ever had, say, nurses come up to you with patient requests?
Yes. Palliative care nurse on the Gold Coast, introduced me to a person that was dying, and she actually recommended because the person was in palliative care and the family never came and visited them. Basically, they dropped their mother off at the hospital and left, never came and visited them, never saw them again. So that lady had the right to air her grievances, and I was there for it. I mean, why not? It was no different to a will reading where we'll get to, I suppose.
I'm curious as to anyone here would be open to using the coffin confessor. Naomi, how about you?
I'm not comfortable with the vengeance side, but as a person who loves gifts, loves surprising people, I kind of love the idea of just, like, having this last word of I love you. And
Ayla?
I think deathbed confessions, are quite selfish, and I find that this service serves that selfishness.
Amanda, what impact can deathbed confessions and requests have on loved ones?
Sometimes they can be a shock, and that can stop the person who has heard the request or the confession, can stop them processing the other things that are going on. So they can become the focus. It can also change your view of the person who is dying and potentially even change the relationship with the person who's dying. And yet that means there isn't really time to renegotiate that relationship, to make sense of it, to reevaluate and reintegrate who you are with that person. And that can interfere with the grieving.
Megan, has your promise to look after your half-siblings affected how you've grieved for your father?
I don't know that it did entirely. I think him asking me when he did was just typical dad, where he hadn't thought things through and he hadn't got his ducks in a row, you know, before something went down. It was very typical of him. So I think I was going to probably struggle anyway with the grieving process because the lead up to his death and the actual death and the time and the everything we put into it was so difficult. I think it perhaps just added to my delayed grieving process, but I don't really know whether it totally altered it or not. I think at the time I compartmentalised my grief and my needs because I did jump into that dutiful daughter, I've got things to do here, look after the kids, make sure they're getting the grief counselling, make sure their living arrangements are all right, all these things. I think I successfully did compartmentalise all that until sort of it was actually about mid last year that it really hit me.
Harley, a few days after you forgave your dad, he died. Did it change how you grieved for him?
I think it allowed me to grieve straight away, and it didn't leave me wondering what if I'd gone to see him, what if I had tried to talk to him more, like, because we had resolved that. I could focus on the grief and focus on the person he was rather than what had happened between him and me.
Mm. Megan, do you ever regret the promise you made?
Oh, yes, no. I wanted to ease his pain and I wanted him... I knew he was holding on because he had so much angst and regret and stress and worries about the future for the living. And so to help him get over the line, that was a choice I made and I'd probably do it again.
Mm. Vicky, you denied your mum's deathbed request. Do you ever regret that decision?
I have regrets that it's fractured the relationship within my whole family. What happened was enormous. That I have regrets over, but my decision to look after myself at that time and insulate myself from the fallout, I think it was absolutely the right decision for me.
Judy, you wanted a confession from your mum before she died. What were you hoping she would tell you?
Who my birth father was.
How long had you been wanting her to tell you that?
Since I was 11 years old.
So when you were 11, this was when your aunts told you that your dad was not your birth father.
Yes.
What did your mum say when you asked her about that?
It's not true and it's a load of rubbish and that my dad is my dad, is my birth father.
And you were told that he was your biological dad, he was the person you grew up with.
Yes, he was my dad, yes.
You then spent several decades searching for the truth. You eventually found your adoption papers. What did they confirm?
They confirmed that I was born Judith Elizabeth Jones in 1950 to an unmarried 16-year-old country girl living in Canamble.
And therefore, Jack, the man you thought was your father,
was the man who adopted me when I was 6 years old.
Did you show those adoption papers to your mum?
No, I didn't. I told her I had them. And in hindsight, I wished I had of, but I didn't. And hindsight's wonderful. I could have had conversations with my dad as well, but I didn't.
What did your mum say when you said, I've got these papers?
They're fraud. You're making it all up. Oh. And even when I showed her my birth certificate and her marriage certificate, and she said, oh, they're not true. You've just got somebody to print them off, you know. Mm. It's all a fraud.
In the days before your mum died, what did you ask her?
I asked her if there was something she needed to tell me about my birth father and if she would tell me who my birth father was, and she said no. And she just shook her head. She said it to Jack, it's your dad.
Did you feel like you had a right to know?
Oh, absolutely. Mum died in 2014, so I thought at that age I had a right to know who my birth father was, and I felt betrayed because of the lies, you know.
Why do you think she denied it?
I don't know. I think she believed her own lies. You know, I don't know why she wouldn't tell me the truth.
You mentioned she was 16 when she had you. Do you think that played into her decision to lie to you?
Yes, I do. She was 16, unmarried, lived in the country with her parents and siblings. I do believe so. And I don't know why she lived a lie, but she did. And she took the truth to the deathbed. Unfortunately.
How do you feel about your mum knowing that she took the truth to her grave?
Oh, I feel betrayed. I mean, I loved her dearly. I love my dad. My dad was the best dad in the world.
Have you been able to forgive her?
I'd like to say yes. I'd like to think of reasons why she wouldn't tell me the truth. I don't think I forgive her for lying to me. Mm. And being deceitful for all of my life. And, yeah, there's nobody that can tell me the truth. So, yeah, I don't think I do forgive her. No, I don't.
You have those medals here with you. Would you mind showing them to us?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Oh, I think my dad would have been over the moon. Mm. Over the moon.
Do you know what each of them is for?
That's the British Star. That's the Defence Medal.
What you do is known as catfishing. How do you do it?
I would just Google pretty white girls and I would just use their pictures and make profiles.
Did you find out who Jasmine really was?
The 25-year-old guy from Sydney.
Who did the coroner find Braden really was?
Braden was Camilla, Renee's best friend.
This is my husband's ashes. They do look like drugs. It's powdery and it's in a little Ziploc bag. If I've got a fly, I put them in a little Ferrero Rocher box. Each of these letters is the place that's left. So there's 9 official drops left. There's a lot left of him, even though he was very small in life. I won't run out. Brian asked me to scatter his ashes in the places that were important to him. They were all around the world and he wanted me to see those places. I was 15 when I met Brian, he was 18. It lasted for 2 years. We separated for what was supposed to be a break, and that little breakup lasted 28 years. When we reconnected, I looked at him and all I could think of was, where's his hair? Because he just looks so different. But it was just like we had never been apart, really. We were together for 9 years and he was diagnosed with throat cancer. And that's when the journey started. When he was declared terminal and it became clear that it really was happening, he said, I don't want to be buried. So I said, why don't you make a list of all the places that you want to go? And when he gave me the list, I said, well, you've nearly got one for each letter of the alphabet, so why don't you do that? So that became his focus, in making one for each letter of the alphabet. The Workers' Soccer Club was so important to him. He was a wonderfully generous man. He was a father figure to so many kids in the club. This was the scene of the first ash drop in 2014, a few months after he died. So it was pretty special. He's been to Greece, he's been into a volcano near Kamina, went over Niagara Falls, he's been off the Empire State Building, he's been into Raffles, he loved Raffles in Singapore. We called it the Ashes Tour. In Italy, I'd climbed the tower, it was a bit windy, and when I sprinkled him, most of him went on the shoulder of a woman beside me. And she looked really annoyed. And I said, look, don't worry, it's just my husband's ashes. It's just become such a regular part of my life now, is doing the travel and the ash drops. And I want to do what he wanted, yeah. He would be happy. he's had quite a few adventures he didn't count on. When I finish scattering the ashes, I think I'm going to feel like my job's been done and I did it in the best way possible. I think I'm just going to feel like I did what I promised him I'd do.
Barb, as well as spreading his ashes around the world, Brian also made you promise something else. What was that?
He made me promise a lot of things. He was a bit of a control freak. But one of his requests was, Ken was one of his dear friends, and Ken's wife found out she had cancer 18 months before Brian died, and he said, he's going to need a friend, so I'd like you to stay in contact with him. So I said I would, and then when Ken's wife died, I'd never met her. Brian had, but I'd never met her. And when she died, I went along to the funeral. A few of us from the club went along, the soccer club. And I just said, if you ever need a cup of coffee or anything, or just talk, you know, get in contact with me. I was going to Canada to do one of the ash drops, and we just kept in contact, and when I got back, we just very slowly. That was over six years ago now.
So you became romantic partners?
In the beginning, I think we were just there for each other. And we both had things we wanted to do that were separate, you know, to each other. And it wasn't something we'd ever imagined, that we were going to have another relationship, because my relationship with Brian was, you know, that was the love of my life.
Yeah.
And Ken felt the same way about Maria. So there was never any feeling that, you know, we're going to find it again.
Jill, your father came to Australia from Poland to work on the hydroelectric scheme after World War II. Did he ever get the chance to go back to Poland?
No, he didn't. He often talked about it, but he never got the opportunity.
Your father died when he was 84. Mm-hmm. What was his wish before he died?
When my dad passed away, I was saying my goodbyes. Told him I loved him, and one of our wishes that we shared together was that we wanted to get his war medals. I promised to my dad that I would get his medals for him.
Did he hear you say that?
He was moments away from passing away, but I feel he knew.
So how did you start down that process of finding them?
I spoke to a few people that were Polish, and they gave me suggestions on who to write to. I did a bit of an investigation myself and thought, oh, well, I'll write to the Polish Air Force, the British Air Force, and just see what they suggest.
Was it difficult to find the medals?
It was a process that took about 3 years. I started 3 years before he passed away, just writing various letters to different organisations. And that was a time where there wasn't a lot of emails and there wasn't a lot of research, you know, on the internet, so it was done the old-fashioned way. So I had to wait for replies. I did get replies from different organisations that just gave me copies of records that we already had.
Jill, 2 months after your father passed away, you got a phone call from your mum. What did she say to you?
She told me that I had a parcel that had arrived from the UK. I basically said, well, could you open it, because we lived an hour apart. And when she opened it, she said, it's your dad's medals. They had come from the UK. The letter that came with them was the Polish Benevolent Society. They had received a letter that I'd written from another organisation, and they discussed the medals that were my dad's, and they decided to pay for them and send them over.
Wow. Yeah. You have those medals here with you. Would you mind showing them to us?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Oh, I think my dad would have been over the moon. Over the moon, yeah.
Do you know what each of them is for?
That's the British Star. That's the Defence Medal. I think that's just a general medal. And that one's the Polish medal. It was given to him for being in the Air Force, the Polish Air Force.
What did finding those medals mean to you?
It made the absolute world to me. Yeah, they're my most prized possession. Yeah, I felt joy. I was so proud, so proud.
Megan, when your dad died in 2020, you promised him you'd look after the children from his third marriage, your half-siblings. What are you doing for them?
Oh, I mean, it varies. Not so much currently, but there's been a fair bit of financial help, emotional support. I got them into grief counselling and just school support, helping their mum or assisting her just sort of establish her life on her own. And she's actually not Australian, so she's still getting used to Australian life and navigating her way through our community and just doing everything on her own, like Dad did so much. And so it's hard for her too. They're great kids, and I, you know, my heart breaks for them that they've lost Dad at such a young age. So, you know, I'd like to be there for them and be around for them. I just need to do that in a way that's going to benefit both of us.
Mm. Is it ever difficult for you to do?
Yes, and it has been difficult simply because of the circumstances. Mm. And there was a lot to accept about who he was and the things that he'd done. Him and I had a very troubled relationship. It's an odd situation and one that, it's taken a while to get my head around. It's not just me, you know, all the family sort of feel the same. It's, you know, the ongoing saga of our family. We joke about another episode in the saga, Bold and the Beautiful, you know, give them a run for their money.
Do you ever feel proud of the way you have managed all this chaos and upheaval in your life?
I don't know that I've ever looked at it like that. I think from early on in my early 20s, I just had to step up and do things, and I realised that I took that role on myself. But at the time, I sort of had to do that. My mum needed help. Her and I are very close to this day. My brother and I are close, and now also with my half-brother. I suppose I've just always taken on that role in the family where I do step up and look after everybody and try to be a bit of a leader and a role model. Probably only recently, or since I had my own daughter, that I realised I have to focus on self a whole lot more because I need to be the best person I can be for my little girl. So I think I've had to readdress the way I deal with the rest of the family so that it's not all on my shoulders. So I've become better at delegating.
Judy, your mum didn't give you the deathbed confession that you really wanted. How do you feel about her now?
I'm still resentful. I started looking for my birth father when I was 11. I'm now 72. Mm. It's been difficult, yes, very difficult.
Do you still feel hurt?
Oh, definitely, yes, definitely, yeah. Massive hole in my heart.
And you mentioned still looking for your birth father. How is that search going?
January last year, I found him.
Oh, really?
After over 60 years of searching.
How did you find him?
Through ancestry DNA.
Did you get to meet him, Judy?
No.
You never
no,
got
he
to
died
meet
in 2011.
What was it like to know that you could have found him and met him in real life but didn't?
It's quite sad because, as I said, I was born in Canamble and I lived in Brisbane eventually as I got older and got married here and had children. And I would drive from Brisbane through Collarenebri to Canamble to visit my mum and dad.
Mm.
My birth father lived in Collarenebri.
So you were
all
really close.
40 years I drove through there, sometimes four times a year.
What does it feel like to know now who your birth dad was?
I have identity. Mm. I know who I am. I know all the medical, some of the medical history in the family, and that's a bonus for me. And to know who he was is just, it's wonderful, you know, even though I never got to meet him, but I've got two half-brothers, so I'm over the moon.
Bill, as the coffin confessor, what do you think your service ultimately gives people?
Closure.
Mm.
Gives them closure. I mean, it's not like you hear all these stories and there's some wicked people in this world, but there's some beautiful people as well. what's left behind is collateral damage. You know, I'm not responsible for that. They are. Mm. They got to deal with it.
Bronnie, you made a promise to a client that changed your life. What was it?
That I would always live a courageous life and live according to my heart, not how other people expected me to.
How did this client make you come to that conclusion?
She was dealing with a lot of regret, and she had stayed in a marriage for decades based on cultural beliefs and worried about what the neighbours would think and things like that, and say to me, Bronnie, promise me, promise this dying woman that you will always have the courage to live a life true to yourself, not a life that other people expect of you. And through my own tears, I said, I promise you, Grace. I promise you I will. And so I made that promise to her, but I also made that promise to myself, because I had witnessed the anguish and pain of regret through her. And so I have. I have always since then. And I do live a really courageous life now on my own terms. And I really don't know if I would have done that had it not been for the promise that I made to Grace.
Harley, has your dad's deathbed request and your decision to forgive him shaped the way you live your life now?
Yes, yes. So, you know, one of the things my dad said to me was, I wish I had learnt from others. I think it's made me understand religion a lot more and people and humanity in general a lot more. I just go out there and tell parents, just accept your kids, don't wait, don't do what my dad did and wait till it's too late.
Have you ever considered an alternate life story for yourself where your dad accepted you as you were when you were younger?
Oh, yeah.
Would you be the same person you are today?
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't. I learned a lot from my dad about forgiveness and humanity and being kind to people. Mm. And I don't think I would have learnt those lessons if he didn't do what he did.
Thank you. It's been such an incredible discussion. I can't thank you enough for your honesty, for sharing such personal stories as well. Thank you too for joining us. Dateline is next.